If I was to say to you the word underground, what would you think of? Old, dirty, needs billions of pounds spent on it? Well, let me tell you, there's another underground system in the UK that very few people know about. It's clean, it's efficient, and it works. And what's more, it's in my hometown of Glasgow.
There's Patty Cross and Seth Stockhill Heath and Merlin Street, George's Cross and Govan Cross, where all the people meet. West Street, Shields Road, the train goes round and round. You've never lived unless you've been on the Glasgow Underground.
It provides a very quick and very reliable service. It's very easy to use. It's a couple of circles going in opposite directions. For a pound, we'll take you from one side of the city to the other in 12 minutes. It provides an excellent opportunity to visit many of the tourist destinations in Glasgow and a lot of the employment centres. And for commuters coming from further afield, we have four park and ride sites, which enables us to facilitate longer distance commuting, providing an alternative to the car for folk when they get in towards the city centre. We've got 15 stations dotted around 10 kilometres of track. During the peak service, we'll have six trains a side, offering a headway of 4 minutes. Off-peak, we'll have three trains a side with a headway of 8 minutes. This year, we hope to transport 13.5 million passengers.
The Glasgow District Subway Act was first passed in 1890 after a few years of negotiation, particularly with the workers on the Clyde. There were a number of different contractors involved and they used a variety of different methods, but the most commonly used method was to use a hydraulic powered steel shield which was pushed through the tunnels, and then the tunnels were reinforced usually with bricks and mortar, but a third of them were reinforced with cast iron where the tunnel passed under the Clyde. It took 5 years, and in 1896 on the 14th of December it was finally open to the public.
Unlike the London Underground, Glasgow employed rope haulage to operate its trains. Now the cables, and there was two of them, were 7 miles long, weighed 57 tonnes each and ran at a constant speed of 12.5 miles per hour. Now the carriages, when they engaged onto the cables, meant that they were going from a stationary position to 12.5 miles per hour, just like that. Now this wheel that I'm turning is what the cable grippers used to engage the carriages onto the cables, and they must have been really strong in those days because this weighs a tonne. And tell me, how reliable was the cable that they used?
It was extremely reliable. It was powered by a power station in Scotland Street on the south side of the city, which was steam powered. And this only was modified when they electrified the system after the Glasgow Corporation, who also owned the extremely popular tram system, took the company over in 1935. And actually on the outside of this carriage, you can see the livery of the Glasgow Transport Corporation. This improved the service vastly, but still they were using the original 1890s cars, so they did become a bit rickety.
The big problem with the system was that it was purely two lines running in two tunnels. There was no point at which they ran into a depot or the like. This had the consequence that any repairs to the vehicles meant that they either had to be worked on in situ or lifted out through a hole at Govan. And similarly, if the permanent way department wanted to get into the tunnels, the loco had to be lifted in and out between operations. This is the original permanent way vehicle with its hooks intact.
Once electrification happened, journey time was cut from 38 minutes to 28 minutes, and the service got a huge amount of popularity for that reason. It peaked in 1949 with a total of 37 million passengers in 1 year, which is just incredible. So these cars really have seen a lot of wear and tear, and by the 1970s there was actually a damaged explosion in one of the tunnels, and that was it. The service just had to shut in 1977. To be fully renovated, and that's when the orange vehicles came in, known affectionately in Glasgow as the Clockwork Orange.
The refurbishment of the system was no small task. The system was closed for around 4 years, during which time stations were rebuilt, track and tunnels relaid and repaired, new stock commissioned, and a turnout chamber was built, giving the two lines a direct connection to the depot at Govan. This is what we love on the Railway Monthly, the nitty-gritty stuff where it all happens. I'm in the control room and Eddie here is one of the team.
Here at the moment you're looking at the almost the entire system of 15 stations and all were trains down on both circles. The monitors cover, we have cameras covering the entire system, all the areas of the system. All the pictures feed back to here. We have visual indication of all our trains, whether in the stations or in the tunnels. The red is the train, the green numbers is the route number of that train, so that we can identify it no matter where it is.
Before this was here, how were the trains controlled?
Pre-1970 there was no control room.
It was controlled
from the stations. Every station was just an island platform. At the end of the station was a small stone box, and that's where the station master lived. He took his meal breaks in there, he worked from there. Each train come into the station, he would go out and he would meet it and he would collect the tickets from the people coming off. The power was fed from each station. So Cessnock would put the power forward to Ibrox, I would put it forward to Govan, all the way around the system and on the inner circle. And in the office at the end of the platform, there was the big electric breakers, and the station master sat among these. If there was a problem that caused that breaker to blow out, it was just about deafening him, but he would just take it all on his stride, find out why it had blown out. Once he realised what it was, he would just put it back in again. Something they would never allow now.
Now, at the risk of sounding obvious, at the end of the day, when the passenger trains have stopped running and they've made their way back to the depot, it's not the end of the day for the Glasgow Subway, because that's when the permanent way team get to grips with the system. Now, Norrie here is team leader of the permanent way system. Tell me, what's the normal working day for the permanent way team?
The working days, unfortunately, consists of night shift work. Our main tasks are to ensure that the underground system is safe for public use the following day, but most of our task is all maintenance work, which is completed on night shift. Our night usually comprises about 4 hours of actual carrying out maintenance work, which varies from replacing rail to cleaning the track, making sure the stations are right, ensuring that there's no fractured or broken rails. We do various tasks, keeping the tunnels, checking the tunnels as such, the general structure of them, and just ensuring that everything's in good shape for the actual following morning for the traffic to run. We usually manage to get in the system, as we call it, approximately 12:30, once we've put the power down, which allows us then to get these Lokis into the system to carry out the maintenance work.
Like this one behind you, this battery?
Exactly, this one here, yeah. We call this one either the flat wagon or wagon 16. And this is one usually basically just used for maintenance work as such. We just carry materials on the back and such like.
The Glasgow Subway has a gauge of only 4 feet, so its tunnels and cars are smaller still than its counterparts in London. And the other interesting thing I noticed are the high-vis jackets, which in normal railway practice would be orange. However, due to the colour of the cars, high-vis jackets in the same colour would have the Health and Safety Department in fits.
As a Glasgow Subway driver, you're just going round in circles all day. Does that not get a bit boring?
No, it doesn't, because every journey is different, because you're picking up different passengers, and you're watching your indications and... there, that's a trip clock test, so that tells you that your train stop safety equipment is working.
Now, one thing I want to point out is you're actually driving the train in manual just now.
Yes.
But normally the trains run in automatic.
Yes they do.
Now that begs the question, if the trains run on automatic, what do the drivers do when it's on automatic?
Well, the drivers are ensuring that the automatic running of the train is running properly, and it's braking properly, it's starting properly, and it's also stopping in the correct position. They're also opening doors, ensuring all passengers enter and leave the train safely, and then closing the doors again, and they start the automatic train movement.
Right, cab ride on the Glasgow Subway. Right, tick that one off in the book.
There's Platy crossing Cessnock, Kilheaton, Melbourne Street. George's Cross and Govan Cross, where all the people meet. West Street, Shields Road, the train goes round and round. You've never lived unless you've been on the Glasgow Underground.